more than anything, he's a man of God. And his pursuit of God, his willingness to hear from God, and his radical desire to obey him is an inspiration to me every time I'm with him. And so I just, if you've not met Marc before, I encourage you to open your hearts and anticipate God speaking through this man to you today. So Marc, we welcome you. May you minister under the, with knowing that you are welcomed into this domain, and that we trust the Holy Spirit to work through you powerfully in this day. So Lord, we bless this man. May he minister under an open heaven. May this be one of those thin places on earth today where heaven touches earth. And you speak to us through this man's life in such a way that our lives will become more like yours. In Jesus' name, amen.
Well, it's a delight to be with you this morning. I always hate to follow David because everybody who follows David sounds a little dumb. But I hope I'm not as dumb as I might sound. But it's great to be with you this morning, see a lot of familiar faces and people I dearly love, place that I love. It's a joy to be here this morning. I understand we have a special group back there that I haven't had a chance to meet yet, the Call2All DTS. Would you stand, all of you that are part of the Call2All DTS? Oh, you're spread around. Well, it's a delight to meet you. I hope to spend more time with you tomorrow morning and we can get to know each other. And if I had a big house like David's, I'd invite you up and we'd eat, but I have a condo. I don't know that the condo people next to me would like that, but great to be with you. All right, open up your Bibles just for a moment to Matthew chapter 5 before I get into this. And I always ask forgiveness in advance for those who are translating, so I get excited and I go fast. But Matthew 5 has become more important to me these last 8-10 weeks. I believe the Lord's just bringing a focus on this portion of Scripture to me. I've heard about it many times, heard some wonderful teachers teach this whole portion of Scripture, including David, who was just up here. I was on a phone call a week ago with Joy Dawson and just felt like I should talk with her. And I always have to get ready for those calls because I can't just plan a half hour or 1 hour. This one, I figured I could do it late in the day and somehow she'd want to go to bed. That didn't happen. I was still on the phone at 2 a.m. But it's a delight. It's not a complaint at all. Any time to get with her is a joy, just like her name. But I was commenting on some things that I thought I was had a lot of wisdom about. You know, and I happened to mention to her that the Lord was featuring Matthew 5 to me and that I was really learning more about some of the qualities that are necessary for the Lord to move not only in your life personally, but to be used of the Lord in all the categories that you want, you know, you want to actually do in your life, or you want to be faithful to follow the Lord in. And she said, well, of course. She said, I was waiting for your call. I always kind of amazed at that. She said, I had 3 points I was meant to give you, the Lord gave me. She said, the first point was that everything depends on humility. And Matthew 5, verse 3, so before I could really unpack what I was learning, she taught me. And it was delightful. And so I just took notes. I just grabbed a pad of paper, listened for about 20 minutes as she unpacked how humility is the foundation piece. It's the first quality that has to be present for everything else to work. And there's intentional humility, and there's humility that comes just through circumstances and things that God orchestrates in our lives. But I would just say to you, in the season that's coming to the earth, that actually has already begun, these Matthew 5 qualities, what we call the Beatitudes, are going to be absolutely essential. And I can't tell you through my own life experience how to enter in all of these and live each of these points. I'm still learning. I'm trying to listen and understand and trust the Lord, who's the author and finisher of my faith and your faith, will take me through whatever process I need to be through, along with my family and everybody around me. But I'm open, I'm listening, I'm, you know, I know intentional fasting and prayer are really key things we can do that help us walk in humility. I'm not sure I'm really good at either one of those, but I know they're necessary. And I know they mark a whole generation that's emerging right now. And that's not an accident. The generation that's emerging right now that the Lord's going to use as the soldiers, the foot soldiers, to carry out this move of God on the earth are marked by fasting and prayer. Those are the qualities that they're really embracing, and they're doing that as they fast, as they pray. They're pursuing the Lord in great intimacy. I mean, you heard the two young men on stage this morning and, you know, talking about the beauty of the Lord. That's not male language normally. That's not normally what you hear young men talk about. The beauty of the Lord, intimacy, come on. That's every wife's dream. But, you know, these soft, kind of flowery marriage language you use, you know, when you're married and then forget the rest of your life. But it's language that's being used because it's language of intimacy with the Lord and a romance with Him. And it's being embraced, male and female. And it's really powerful stuff. You know, I'm a grandfather now. Seventh grandchild came last Wednesday. Little Justice came into the world. And so I'm trying to track with these 16, 18-year-olds, 14-year-olds, 11-year-olds. They're dynamically pursuing the Lord. My debate's at home right now. My wife and I have to deal with conflicts with our three teenagers. We have a preteen and three teens, and two of them drive. And the conflicts are all around staying out too late at night. But they want to stay out too late at night to go to the International House of Prayer in Kansas City and pray through the night. And one of my children, you know, is 17, and he can't drive past 1 o'clock. And I said, you can't go out. I'm sorry. You cannot stay at the house of prayer. You have to be home before 1 o'clock because you're not allowed to drive. Okay, Dad, what if I go with somebody who's 1 year older and they can stay out later? Can I stay till 2 and pray? Well, I'm not sure. Well, if you're home at 2, it's okay. And I hang the phone up and I go, is this a dream? I called my daughter up yesterday, who's 19, Kirsten, and I just, you know, saying hi and enjoying her, and she had this raspy voice, and I said, Kirsten, what is going on? You know, you've had a raspy voice now for a couple of weeks, and, you know, you're fighting some sickness or something. She says, oh, no, Dad, yesterday I was in a time of prayer and worship with some other young people, and it was just so good. We sang for 6 hours. What are you going to say? Stop singing, go rest your voice, cut it out. You know, and it's just that world right now. The young people that are emerging are so in love with Jesus. And I have to scold her. This is not a lie, and I'm not bragging on my kids. I'm just observing. I'm just amazed at what's going on. I'm convicted, to tell you the truth. I have to scold Kirsten to eat. I said, well, you mean you're fasting again? I just barbecued. We just had this wonderful meal prepared, and you're telling me you can't eat? I'm sorry, Dad. I really am. I'd love to eat with you. I'll sit at the table and watch you. But she's fasting again. And to her, it's not a big deal. All right, that's a mark of what God is doing with a generation in the earth. Now, we have a challenge because very few of us in this meeting are 16, 18, we're not of that group. All right, so how are we going to track with this? We have a little different role in what's unfolding right now. And really what's been talked about these weeks through these meetings you've been in is a lot of it. We've learned a few things, hopefully. We have some understanding of the key points foundationally. Hopefully we have a little bit of a grid on what's happening in the world and what's ahead for these young people and how the enemy works and where the pitfalls are. And we've got to really participate in this whole process. This move of God at the end of the age is not something we're just going to watch young people do. Each age group, each generation has to participate in their category. And as I was listening to David just unpack a few of the points, even though I'd heard them before, and I heard Darlene talk about these points before, I was listening with new ears because we're going to launch something called Call2All Next Generation in January, which is all geared toward the emerging generation. So it's not the older leaders getting together and talking about how they can partner to finish the Great Commission. It's a younger generation who wants to engage in this that doesn't have all the life experience. They're not presidents and CEOs of companies and agencies and denominations. but they're an emerging group that want to make a difference, and they're going to have to learn a lot of things. And the foundations that they've talked about with you these past weeks are the very foundations we have to lay with that younger generation. They have to hear that. They can't just move into strategy and miss the foundational pieces. There's a whole new way of thinking and seeing things. There's a whole new set of characteristics they have to operate in, you know, personal character, what their value systems are. It has to be laid. We can't avoid those personal things in their lives. We have to start with them. And so anyway, there's a lot going on right now. I'm quite excited about it. I want to talk to you for a little bit about the journey I've been on the last few years and what I see the Lord doing in the earth. Now, if we can for just a moment, let's move back a little bit and kind of take this 40,000 feet above ground look at stuff. Let's take a look at the bigger picture of what's happening in the earth to understand the times that we're in. Now, you've had a lot of that probably, but I'll come at it from a little different direction. It's one thing for me to say to you that the events of the end times, whatever that means, 20 years, 50, 100 years, we don't know what that is. Only the Father knows. But it's one thing for me to say to you we're in those times. It's another thing to talk about the actual fulfillments of particular categories prophetically of the promises of God in Scripture and to see what is unfolding before us, because we're moving into a season of shakings. They're coming closer and closer together. They're going to be more and more violent shakings. There's going to be a lot of turbulence in the earth as the Lord reveals who He is, as His glory is demonstrated and revealed. His justice is going to be exercised. And, of course, it all culminates with the second return of Christ. And so we're going to be living out some of this. You know, for whatever number of years we're here and however long this takes, we need to be aware of this. And it really isn't business as usual in any way. And so there's new language coming really quick. There's lots of different ways we have to live. We've got to really just translate this into how do we have families? How do we actually earn a living? What happens in living in community? What does community look like? How do we actually do ministry in the midst of all the shakings when people are so ready to turn to Jesus? How do you actually get to them? How do you pay for it? How do you organize it? There's so many questions to be asked right now. But you can't answer any of the questions if we don't know the bigger picture. Okay, that makes sense? If you get the bigger picture of what's going on, then we even know from a mission standpoint where to really put our resources, what to focus on. We know what fight we're fighting. We're not going to get ambushed in some way. We're not going to, like so many in history, miss the main storyline of the time. You know, David gave you all sorts of history pieces. The church has got a long history of missing what's going on. Let's not miss what's going on. Let's be right in the middle of it. How many know the Lord wants to show us ahead of time? A lot of it. Come on. He wants to show us if we'll listen. All right, so let's just listen to some story here. There's actually a spirit of prophecy that the Bible talks about. It's a particular anointing of the Holy Spirit that comes when we talk about what the Lord's doing and we talk about prophetic stories. And actually preaching in its purest sense, what's talked about in Acts chapter 2 in the last days, when the sons and daughters will prophesy, that is prophetic messaging. That's a whole different, that's not just taking a John 3:16 message, but that's moving by the Holy Spirit like Peter did on the day of Pentecost, where you're actually speaking right from the heart of the Lord by the Holy Spirit. And that's the kind of voice we have today. So I want to release a little bit of that, stir a little of that up here in the next few minutes with some stories of what the Lord's doing in the earth. In 2000, there was an event in Amsterdam. Some of you were probably there. Billy Graham put together what was his last big global conference, Amsterdam 2000, August of the same year. And when he drew together 8,000 evangelists from some 150 or 60 nations, how many of you were part of that? Anybody here? A few of you? Martin was. Before that gathering, as only the Graham organization could do, they were organizing all sorts of things. And I received a phone call about 3 months prior to the Congress, and they asked if I would participate with 400 other leaders around the world from different nations in a prep time leading up to the Congress, and then at the Congress itself, sitting at tables like this in breakout sessions, to consider how to finish the Great Commission. Now, that's quite an audacious thing to think about. I mean, really, there's just even the idea that we could sit down and have that discussion excites me, but even offends some. Like, that's only left with the Lord, we can't know. Don't over-spiritualize it. The Lord clearly told us we're supposed to, so it's okay to ask. You know, so what they did. All right, they asked if I would be part of this forum. So the forum took place 3 months prior, where we interfaced through web. You know, at that time, somewhat of a new technology, and we were answering questions, and they were collating all the answers in major categories of what we call finishing the Great Commission, things that they thought were important. When we got to Amsterdam in the August of that year, we were told that we were going to be part of some tables behind the scenes, that 400 of us would be around tables of eight. We'd have table moderators, and we'd do that for 6 days. So among that group were a lot of the top leaders in Christendom from around the world, from the various countries. And they would put questions in front of us every day, the same questions we were dealing with online before we arrived. And we would have discussions around the tables, and then we would actually write down some answers, and they would collate the answers and put them up front for us. And we were really working through a lot of stuff. It was fun. Now, the table I was at was moderated by Dr. Steve Douglas, who's the president of Campus Crusade for Christ. Actually, he just had become the president, taking over after Bill Bright, which is not an enviable thing to do. I mean, that's a tough thing to follow. You know, the founder of Campus Crusade, but he was getting later in his years and starting physically to deal with some very serious issues. And so Steve Douglas just had taken over, and so he was kind of overwhelmed, but he was the moderator at our table. And so we're good friends, and we were having a great time. The third day of that meeting, now get the setting, we're behind the scenes 6 hours a day at tables while the main conference is going on. The third day, we're at the table, and Paul Eshelman and Bruce Wilkinson stood up on the stage, and they gave a challenge to us. First, they put on the table all the list of what we called then the untargeted, unreached people groups, something you're going to hear more about. Now they're called unengaged, unreached people groups. But then they were untargeted, unreached, and the list was a little different. What we found out later, it wasn't a great list, but it was the best shot we had in 2000. Because they were at about 230 at that time, and we found out there's a lot more. But they put the list in front of us. We're paging through who these groups are and where they're located. And then Paul and Bruce stand up and challenge us. And they said there shouldn't be any untargeted, unreached people groups. Just the fact that we would have groups untargeted is a reproach to the body of Christ. So we're going to commit right now to reach them. And we'd like different ones in this room to look at the list and stand up and commit that you're going to go reach that particular group, penetrate that group with the gospel. Well, that was a powerful challenge. People began to stand up all over the room. I mean, this is one of the most electric times I've ever been in. Can you just imagine if right here you represented all these different major organizations and businesses and, you know, all around the world from the different cultures, and you were standing and say, I'll take that group over there in India. I'll take that one over there in Malaysia. I'll take, they were doing that. And it was just moving along, and you could feel it. I mean, there was just energy in the room, and people were clapping, and it was a wonderful time. Until they got about halfway. And then it stopped. It was an absolute bummer. I mean, it was just flat. Nobody was responding. Bruce was up front trying to exhort everybody. Come on, one more, one more. It's hard to sound a bit like an auction. And it just didn't go anywhere. And we were depressed. I mean, frankly, it was just it seemed like a very long time we were waiting in the room. I'm sure it was only 5 minutes. And Steve's sitting next to me. And, you know, he looked at me. I'm the YWAM guy. And, of course, he's the president of Campus Crusade. And, you know, everybody's always trying to figure out in YWAM who's in charge. But I was the only YWAM guy in the room. So he leans over to me and he says, why don't we have our two organizations, YWAM and Campus, take the rest of the list? Well, my mind is going, yeah, right, Steve. You don't get YWAM. You don't send out a memo in YWAM to tell everybody to do something. You know, it has hundreds of flavors, and people do whatever the Lord might lead them to do. Anyway, that's going on in my mind. My spirit is saying, yes, 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 this is right. So what do you do? So I just look over at him, and I go, well, okay, Steve, sure. Well, I thought it was a private conversation. He gets up from the table, walks up to the front, tells the moderator, said, YWAM on campus will take the rest of the list. And, of course, the reason that nobody wanted the rest of the list is just that it's the group of people groups that you can go into but may not get out of. The hard ones. So anyway, they announce it up front. YWAM on campus are going to take the rest of the list. Everybody stands to their feet and they're cheering. And I'm still sitting. I'm going, oh my gosh. What did I just do? I mean, I have a whole bunch of other ministry things I'm doing. How would I possibly lead this out, take this on? I mean, I don't have any framework on this, any history. I'm not a people group guy. You know, it doesn't fit me. What did I just do? I mean, self-condemnation was flowing. I mean, I think I used language concerning myself like dumb, stupid, whatever. But there I am, okay? They just announced it. So everybody goes to coffee break. And they're all anxious to go to coffee break. And you know, after 3 days of meetings, they just out of the room. Steve and I are still sitting there. Okay, he must be thinking the same thing. I just took over the presidency of Campus Crusade for Christ. What did I just do? You know, because they aren't known for people group stuff either. So we're just sitting there, and I look at Steve, and I go, Steve, what does reach mean? Now, I have to be honest here and confess, I was looking for a simple way to define reach that didn't cost too much. You know, I thought about this later. Maybe we could just go over in a hot air balloon, drop tracks in the languages, and we wouldn't even have to go in and get arrested. You know, that kind of thing. So I said, Steve, what is reach? And he took the question very serious, and he said, well, I suppose if we're going to have the Bible. The Bible has to be available in that language, and it wasn't in any of those groups. So as we're saying that, and he actually said, Wycliffe does most of that work. They do 90% of all the translation work in the world. As he says that, up walks Roy Peterson, who is the president of Wycliffe. And Roy... And we look to Roy, and Steve says, Roy, we were just talking about you. We're looking for somebody to partner with to commit to do translation work in all these people groups that, you know, we just volunteered for. And he said, I'm in. We want that. He sat down at the table with us. Well, that was cool. Well, then I said, well, we're going to have church planting. And we just reviewed the church planting movements through the IMB, the Southern Baptist Convention, and all their thousands of churches that were being planted in indigenous, spontaneous fashion all through Asia, and just the model, how wonderful the model was, and David Garrison had made a presentation. And so I just said, well, that group is the one we need. We need them in here to help with the church planting. As I said that, the person that was actually overseeing that, helping to for the IMB, helping to manage it, Avery Willis, walks up to the table. And I said, Avery, we were just talking about you. You know, we'd like to have you involved with this. We need church planting in all these groups. And he said, I'm in. He pulls up a chair, sits down. So I'm going, okay. Well, we need somebody to tell us from a research standpoint where the church planting movements are in the world, because there's already movements happening. We can just partner with the existing movements. If we can find one nearby the people groups are trying to reach, then that's the easiest to get in. And as I'm saying that, I mentioned... Well, that's DAWN, which stands for Discipling a Whole Nation. They do all kinds of research. The president of DAWN, standing behind me, he taps me on the shoulder and he says, can I sit down at the table? We'd like to be involved with this. That happens through seven different themes and seven different organizations all during the half-hour break. So at the end of the half-hour break, they're all sitting around at the table fully ready to participate in their categories. Look out when you say yes to Jesus in something that he's stirring you on that you don't think that you can do. I mean, it's just really important to understand that God will do 99% of it if you'll just say yes if you believe it's the Lord. I mean, just watch what'll happen. Just track with him. So we're all sitting at the table, And, of course, everybody's walking back in the room, seeing that we're all sitting with each other. We're writing down a constitution for this thing and, you know, what the mission statement will be and how we're going to meet together. And the rest of the folks are starting to gather around us, and they're watching, they're listening, and it's got a buzz in the room. Next break, we all meet again. Next break, we meet again. We just meet for several days in all the breaks. We form the whole thing. And we're trying to name ourselves because we don't want to be known. You know, we don't want anybody interviewing us. We don't want articles in Christianity Today. We don't want to go any, you know. We want to be incognito, unknown. Everybody at the table already had a lot they were doing. This wasn't about, you know, getting a new identity. And so each table was numbered. You know, all the tables in the room, and ours was table 71. So I said to the guys, let's just call it table 71. Nobody will know what that is. And they haven't for years, I know now, but it protected us for many years. Nobody, they always would go, what's that? Which is what we wanted. Because, you know, it wasn't the Great Commission Initiative, and, you know, all the top guys finished the Great Commission Together organization. It wasn't that, it was Table 71. So we agreed to meet three times a year from that point on. And from that grouping, which has grown, the Lord has brought all these initiatives, many of that you're going to hear about this week. And it's just been a phenomenal group. David joined me, David Hamilton, and, you know, we participated in that since. Others have. It's just been a dynamic partnership of people together. It took us a while to partner, learn how to partner, how to move in unity with each other. But that's one of the storylines that's bringing a release. That's brought the orality network you're going to hear about this afternoon with all these different organizations involved. It brought changes with Wycliffe, where they had to take their goals from 125 years for all the Bible translation down to 25. They started new companies like the Seed Company. All that, those are the things that came out of this partnership. So some of the greatest missions initiatives of history have come out of a partnership, a John 17-style partnership, and where the Lord has brought us together strategically. All right, so that's the first storyline, and that's continuing to grow. It's amazing to have, watch who's at the table, you know, the mix of people that are there, and we dearly love each other. People would have said before Table 71 that those groups wouldn't even be with each other, that because of their, you know, beliefs and theology and, you know, the perspectives, they wouldn't even be at the table together, but we're dear friends. All right, another storyline. I get a call in 2002 from Bill Bright's office, and Bill Bright is dealing with something at the end of his life that the Lord just won't let him get rid of. And he has this burden on him that he's meant to unify, help unify the body of Christ in the world, again, to help fulfill the Great Commission. And he's doing his best. Anytime God stirs you with something, you just do your best. It's, how many know it's imperfect? It's all really imperfect. But, you know, he's getting very deep encounters with the Lord. Some are like visitation encounters that he should use the equity he's built in all the years of ministry to help bring together the body of Christ. So he starts the Global Pastors Network, and they want me to be on the board. And I said, well, I haven't been a pastor in a long time. You know, maybe you want somebody else. Oh, no, no, we want you on the board. You know, you're the YWAM guy. I was the YWAM guy again, whatever that was. So I said, well, what is this? Well, they tried to give me a real confident answer, but the truth was they weren't quite sure yet. That's the truth, okay? And so, but I agreed. I mean, it's Bill Bright, and it felt right, and sure. So we had some board meetings, and we talked about some stuff and did some conferences, but the truth was a lot of it was pretty boring. A lot of it had a lot of hype, but not a lot of substance yet. And they knew it. In fact, a lot of the Campus Crusade guys weren't that excited about it themselves because they watched, you know, a bunch of hype and some things. And that wasn't Dr. Bright. By that time, he was actually in a bed in the hospital through a lung disease, and he was, you know, moving toward dying. And he was trying to function and lead this thing, brought some leadership in that didn't get missions. You know, they were available. But they didn't have a global perspective, missions perspective, so they were taking it the wrong direction. It became a meeting that was really, in many ways, what Dr. Bright didn't want. He wanted no logos and no egos, and there was tons of logos and a lot of egos. But, you know, it's imperfect. We were participating. I was part of it. I pulled David Hamilton in again, you know, and to do some of the things with it. In 2005, the chairman of the board for GPN was John Maxwell. And you probably know Dr. Maxwell from his writings on business and, you know, leadership training and that sort of thing. But he approached me in Dallas, Texas in 2005, and he said, listen, we've got to have a strategy for this. And I said, yeah, you know, I've been telling you that, John. You really do need a strategy for GPN. And he said, I was thinking you'd write one. And I said, why me? Why would you want me to write this? Why don't you go to some of your leaders and have them write it? And said, no, I really think you've got a lot of the strategy we need. Why don't you write the strategy for GPN? It's a long story, but I finally agreed. So I did write up a strategy. In 2006, again, David Hamilton helped me on this. We put together some strategic pieces. And they tried to implement some of it, but again, it was kind of clumsy. And I had already determined by the end of 06 that I was going to quietly back out of GPN. Dr. Bright had gone to be with the Lord. I didn't have to worry about that anymore, you know, in terms of not disappointing him. I'm sure he had some vantage point from heaven, but I thought, okay, I can get out of this now. And there also were some organizations that already had pulled out, major ones. So I figured, well, I'm just one of many, and that won't be a big deal. And so I was thinking in my mind I was pulling out. It was at the end of 2006. Now, David asked me to tell some of this story just to give you some of the ways of the Lord and how this stuff works, okay? So I'm giving you some detail. I'll give you some personal elements. I didn't want to even be part of it anymore at that point. I thought it just too messy, you know, too much stuff I didn't agree with. And then at the end of 06, I was in Medicine Hat, Alberta with my wife at Christmas time, and we had all the grandkids there. By the way, the 7th just arrived last Wednesday. Little Justice is now with us. But anyway, I was up there with Karen, and we were having this great time with the kids, and we agreed that I would cut back on my travel, which sounded so good, because I'd traveled 220 days that year. And I thought, this will be nice. So I'll just trim back. We'll start with 40 or 50 days cut back, you know, get it down to 180 maybe, and which is still insane. And just trim it back some more. And we're just playing with the grandkids, and, you know, two of my daughters just had new babies. And, I mean, you understand, it was just really good. And I wasn't answering any messages or emails or texts or anything. I was just having fun. And I was getting all these encounters with the Lord. We were praying. I had this dream one night where the Lord was showing me the coming move of God and the prayer movement and the missions movement coming together. And I was just stoked. Okay? Came out of the Christmas experience. January 3rd, Steve Douglas calls me. He's on the board for GPN with John Maxwell and some of the other guys. And he says, we've been praying over Christmas. We're going through a transition. We removed some of the leadership of GPN. We were praying about the new leadership, and we believe the Lord showed us that you're to be the new president. Now, I had it on speakerphone. My wife was in the room. And she in the background goes, no way! Now, if you know Karen, that's totally out of character for her. That just came right out of her heart. And Steve starts laughing. He hears her. And I said, Steve, you know, we just talked about cutting back, and you know I'm busy and lots going on. And he says, I understand. And hung up. Okay. Well, a week later, calls back again. And he said, we've been praying, and we still feel like you're the right guy. And I started naming all these other people that they should be asking. And then I reminded him, I'm YWAMer. I said, this is weird. I mean, that's Bill Bright's thing. You're a Campus Crusade founder. I mean, I'm a YWAMer. I like you guys, but you don't want a YWAMer. And he said, oh, that's not a problem. Just stay in YWAM and keep doing everything you're doing. Just add this. That didn't sound attractive at all. It sounded to me like a bunch of work. And I already knew the thing was in debt. I knew that some of the organizations involved at that point were already disliking it. You know, so I had a ton of PR to do if I would ever take it. You know, there was no staff anymore, so I'd have to find them. I mean, that did not sound good at all. But I have to tell you that in here, there was a conviction. There was a stirring. Which, how many of the Lord is still patient? And he usually gets his way. Not always, but he usually gets his way with us if we're not too stubborn. So I say no. I hang up. Week later, Steve calls again. Now, this is January 18th. It's my son Josiah's birthday, which I really didn't remember when he called. But later, that was important to me. I won't give you all the reasons why, but that day, every year is a prophetic day. This God does stuff every year on that day. And the ways of the Lord are just, there's so much to learn. But God pays attention to things like that. But anyway, so he calls that morning again. He said, we still feel you're supposed to be part of this. And I sheepishly say no again. January 18th, 2007. So I get a call right after that from my wife, and she says, you know, honey, we're not going to be home this afternoon. The house is going to be empty. I've got the kids at sports events. And, oh, that sounded good. I just come back from a trip, and I was jet-lagged, and having an empty house and no activity sounded really nice. So I went home midday, and I'm just sitting in a chair, and I go to sleep sitting up. I'm just enjoying this midday nap, and I'm deep sleep, and the presence of the Lord moves into the house. Now, I don't see anything at that point, but I knew it. I immediately was awake, cut to my heart, convicted intensely of sin. I mean, I didn't know I had so many. Honestly, I'm not being funny. I mean, it was like the lights were all turned up, and I just saw all the crud and how ugly it was and just an awareness of it. And some of it I, of course, knew very well. Some of it I didn't. And all I could do was hit the floor and just put my face down on the carpet and just, you know, cry. Just repent. I spent 2 hours repenting, and I'm going, all the time in the back of my mind, I'm going, what is happening? Are you losing it? What is this? But, you know, I knew it was the Lord. So I kind of got up, went into the den, turned on some worship music, and then for the next 4 hours, I already had 2 hours of the deep holiness aspects, the fear of the Lord pieces. The next 4 hours, the Lord starts unpacking to me through all sorts of different ways some of what's going on the earth. And he actually took me back and showed me some of the things he'd given to Dr. Bright. You know, God uses individuals, but he has something in mind. And it's one thing to hear about something that somebody got, you know, or even hear from Dr. Bright about what he had. But it's a whole other thing when the Lord helps you understand exactly what he told them. And I felt some of the same feelings, I'm sure, that Dr. Bright felt, the urgency, the necessity of bringing the church together in the earth. It's like a deposit went in me for that whole anointing. And then the Lord brought me back to a lot of what he had shown me about Youth of the Mission, the purposes of YWAM in the earth, and how God has raised this organization up to be used ultimately as a delivery system for the coming move of God that's going to be in the earth. That's why he strategically keeps pushing us out to new places all the time. It's one of the many things he has in mind, but it's really a key element to understand why YWAM is so consumed, why our founders are so, you know, pushed going everywhere to get everywhere, and why we have maps all the time, and why we're always trying to find the next geographical location. That's all of the Lord to prepare for what's coming. But I had a new understanding of that. The Lord brought some old things back up. So I'm getting that piece. Now, in the midst of that, the only way I can describe this to you is I get like a movie that the Lord brings to me. It's a vision of a sort. And I've seen this before. It's happened a number of times over the last 25 years. But I see the harvest of the earth. And I want you to understand what I mean by that term. Now, there's two aspects of that in Scripture. One has to, and it's all built on God's justice. But the two aspects are the terrible side of it, which is all of the things that are challenged in the earth, the shakings that are coming, the turbulence in the earth that's going to be here and is increasing, we'll see more of very soon. I think some of it before the end of the year. And the other aspect is a whole generation being drawn in to an understanding of who the Lord is, and a lot of them coming to Christ. I don't know how many exactly, but I think it'll be at least a billion. Not a million, a billion, which would be almost a doubling of the church on the earth. But seeing masses come into the kingdom of God by a move of the Holy Spirit. Just a spontaneous, you know, move of God, just moving through a generation completely. And this generation is captivated, captured by a revelation of who the Lord Jesus is. So I'm watching this, right? And it always stuns me. And when this happens, this kind of stuff occurs. And then in the midst of that, I get an internal audible voice that comes from the Lord. And he just speaks to me, John 17:1. The time has come for the Son to be glorified. It's one thing to read a verse. It's a whole other thing when the Lord speaks it to you, and especially when it's about him. But I understood. It's just like a download again. John 17, the whole picture there of unity, which is about you and I becoming one with the Son and the Father as they're one with each other. The same oneness. And when that happens, the world will know. There's a oneness factor that's necessary for the world to know. That in itself could be a teaching for a week. There's so much in that. We're not going to see the revealing of the Lord Jesus Christ in the earth until there's a true oneness that is arrived at among the church in some level. And that oneness will be the same as the oneness between the Son and the Father, where it's just an absolute unity. And that's why, again, another reason why I believe this younger generation is so consumed with the pursuit of the Lord himself. If they were driven to missions and they bypassed intimacy, then you would not find a oneness. You might have a strategic oneness, but you wouldn't have a oneness with the Lord himself. They are moving right now, they meaning the whole movement, the whole prayer movement on various levels around the world are moving right now into missional things in a very strong way. I might get a chance this week to unpack for you some of the meetings I've been in the last 2 weeks with some of the key leaders in the global mission prayer movements. But I'm working with them right now, mapping out strategy for them. They are implementing, and it's so exciting. It excites me on so many levels. It's not just exciting that they're engaging a lot of the missional things that we've helped define, but they're engaging it with a group of people that spend their life praying and fasting, that have deep strength and maturity and character because of what they've pursued now for a period of years. And look out. You know, this is a powerful thing God's bringing forth right now. But back to this encounter on January 18th. I'm getting an understanding of these two elements, the terrible and the glorious side, the unity factor that had to be, in this whole thing, the Lord speaking to me. And I knew in that moment that I had to say yes to this thing called GPN. Global Pastors Network. And I was so grateful that my wife arrived home and got the last hour of this thing, because I would have had to try to explain it to her, and I didn't want to be convincing her of something this significant. But she got a download from the Lord herself, and there was a huge conviction there, and it was confirmed by Lauren, John Dawson, and David within 4 days, you know, in a very sovereign way. All right, so now I had a Global Pastors Network, but I had a bunch of people who wanted to work with it that weren't pastors. What do you do with business people that want in on this thing? Or civic leaders or educators or some other category, media people. They didn't want to join a pastor's network, right? Okay, but they want in. Whatever it is, they want in. So we struggled with that for a little while I was kind of fixing up the GPN piece and trying to pay the bills, and Campus Crusade stepped up on that one and re-engage some organizations that had stepped out and try to build broader unity. In the midst of that, praying about what to do here, a banner that we could use that everybody could be part of. And it was later that year in April, I was with David Hamilton out in Los Angeles, and the Lord made it really clear that it was Call2All. Actually, some people here that helped design that, put that phrase together, you know, allowed us to use it, but Call2All. The idea being everybody's called to everybody, all to all. It's the alls of the Bible. It just covers the whole thing, right? It's the Great Commission in every facet. And then under that, you have a global pastors network, a global business network, a global educators network, a global compassion network, all the different networks you might need, and the affinity groups that are necessary. Whatever somebody would want to be part of, they could have an on-ramp into this thing, and they could be unified together with other parts of the body of Christ to work together to finish the Great Commission. All right, so over here we've got table 71. Over here, this Call2All thing's emerging, and the idea is that we would initially bring together top leaders of organizations around the world and get them at tables, work with them for a period of time, about 3.5 days, in these congresses, so they could strategically align themselves and work together to finish the Great Commission. Now, that the first one was January of 2008 in Orlando, Florida. I started there just out of honoring Bill Bright and let Vonette Bright, his wife, be part of the first one so she could see that fulfillment. All right, that is built. How many of you are part of Hong Kong? Just the meeting we just had, about half of you. That was the first international congress. We've been doing regional congresses up to that. That was the first international congress. And I have, you know, you've heard about that already, no doubt. Lauren's probably talked about it. I won't go into too much detail. It just came out of another word of the Lord. That's important for you to know. It was the middle of 2008, and I was sensing the Lord wanted an international congress, and we were praying about it. I was with Dave Cole, one of our YWAM leaders. We were together in South Africa. That was kind of weird. We were at Graham Power's house, you know, who founded the Global Day of Prayer, and we're all praying. And had a sense that God wanted us to do something in China. And that's where it came from. Now, I tried to actually, again, take it over to Singapore because it made more sense to me in my head. Because I was really not, I was fearful that perhaps if we did something in China, it would expose all these missions agencies and missionaries. And but you can't think too much. You just have to obey the Lord. God sovereignly took it back where it was supposed to be, and we ended up in Hong Kong. And the Lord brought together 3,000 leaders, half of whom were Chinese and the other half were from 100 nations. And if you weren't in Hong Kong, God really rocked us. Now, I want to tell you something, and I know you've had a lot of information today. And before I get to a main point here that I really want to put focus on, but I haven't announced this because, truthfully, I can't announce this in most forums because when I announce it, people take it wrong. And I'm having to really get wisdom from the Lord. Even I want to give God glory for what he's doing, but I don't want to make it seem like we're trying to be a big deal, okay? I don't, in my heart, see it as building a big organization at all. I really think it's stewardship of a movement. And most of the time, I just feel like really inadequate, okay? Like, God, don't let it blow up, you know? So that's easy for me. I can pretty well stay humble any day on that one just by looking at my email. And somebody's always mad, and there's always some new thing to fix. But it's working. That's the amazing thing. But here are the commitments that were made. This week you're going to participate in this if you haven't done this before. You can't encounter the Lord and deal with something without saying yes to it on some level. Like repentance is necessary. You can't talk about sin without doing something. It's not enough to say, yeah, I agree with that, and then walk away and not change. You've got to respond to it. So you can't talk about the Great Commission challenges, which are commands of God, and then walk away and not say yes to what the Holy Spirit stirs you to do. So I'm warning you ahead of time. If you don't want to hear God and you don't want new commitments, don't come this week, because you'll be responsible for what you hear. So we move toward commitments, and those commitments are hopefully covenant relationships with the Lord that we'll be actually walking forward, putting in front of the Lord. Well, they did this in Hong Kong, 3.5 days of processing. The environment was, in my mind, stunning. A lot of us who are not Chinese, are not from the mainland of China, and hadn't gone through what they've gone through for several generations, participated with them and experienced what they paid for, more and more the presence of God through humility. And in that environment, God spoke to the people who were present. It took us days to process the commitments. We had commitment forms this high off the floor in great detail in 7 themes. But this is what they committed. Now, I want you to know, we threw out the ones that we thought might be erroneous or, you know, somebody was just overexcited. We really went through these and tried to figure out, as best you can, is this doable? Is this real? You know, should we count it? And I'm sure we threw out some valid commitments in that process, but we just didn't want to be exaggerating anything here. So here's the numbers. These are after all the pruning, okay? The folks at the meeting committed to start 456,000 new prayer watches or houses of prayer in every Omega Zone on Earth. I'm going to stop a little bit after each one of these. I just, you know, that puts it over 500,000 total with other congresses that we had, 550,000. I don't know if there's ever been that much prayer in any time, and I know there hasn't. That's just an understatement. Okay. David's back doing math. But you guys, it's just moving. Anyway, I'm talking with the prayer leaders extensively right now about the follow-through on that and all the different languages, and they're preparing whole curriculums and courses and web courses and all sorts of stuff to service that. The next group, and you're going to hear more about UUPGs this week, and we have a 639 list. That goes back to that first story I gave you about Table 71. When we went back and researched it, we found out there were 639 unengaged, unreached people groups over 100,000 in size, okay, making up about 560 million people in the world that had no Bible, no Christian presence, no witness of any kind that we know of, okay? So it was a little bit bigger list than we had actually engaged in the year 2000. Well, we've been working now the last 3 years deliberately as Table 71 trying to get people to engage those UUPGs. And it was really tough, you guys. The first meetings we held, we did one at the Billy Graham Cove, and we had leaders there. They almost did nothing. And even what they committed, they didn't do. So we were frustrated. Like, can we get anybody to engage these groups? They're tough groups, you know. We understand. But I'm trying to track through, so Steve, the commitments we made back in 2000. Right? At this last Congress in Hong Kong, there were 194,000 commitments to the 639. And I've gone through those lists. I keep going through those lists. Before that, in the previous four Congresses, there were thousands of commitments toward the UPGs. Let me just tell you this. Paul Eshelman leads this whole category, and if you don't know Paul, he did the Jesus Film Project for years. He does the best job of researching what actually is going on after the fact, the follow-through pieces. He brought this report several weeks ago to our Table 71 meeting. And he said, because of our activity of trying to recruit people into the unengaged, unreached people groups, we have now engaged 337 of the 639. And of those engagements include 1,267 new full-time workers working in the people groups. When there were none. Come on, you guys. There are 80,900 known new believers in those people groups. There are 39,000 recorded baptisms. There are 6,350 new church plants in those unengaged, unreached people groups. Come on, this has got to excite you. I mean, 2,537 part-time workers that are nearby going in and out. And that most of this, almost 90% of it, has happened in the last 90 days. Go to call2all.org. I'm not being funny. Call2all.org, and you'll find on there the story I told you about Table 71, and you'll find on there the numbers I just gave you on the homepage, so you can all get them. But you guys, this is happening. This does not include what happened in Hong Kong. This is before Hong Kong. This is because of the activity that's gone on in the last couple of years. The Call2All Congresses have only been happening. All my notes are blowing away. I hope I remember them. Cool. I put my glasses on it, but they blew away too. This is really happening. We are tracking these commitments right now in all of these categories. You're going to be hearing about a rally this afternoon. And through the oral Bible teams, people are hearing the gospel that have not heard for 2,000 years. Again, at over two-thirds of the world cannot or will not receive the gospel through a literate approach. So there has to be some oral approach. But in Hong Kong, there were 282,000 new commitments to start orality teams in all the Omega zones of the world. We have commitments from Hong Kong for 2.1 million new church plants. It's estimated there's about 7 million churches right now in the world. You can do the math and the percentages. David might get there first. We counted the gospel commitments. This is the evangelism portion. We did not count in this report the media evangelism, because those numbers sometimes are really hard to track, television, radio, and so on. The commitments made to approach people on a personal level, either through some kind of evangelistic campaign, one-on-one work, all the different ways, but the commitments through personal encounters of the gospel between now and 2020 is that there will be 5.8 billion new gospel presentations, or 5.8 billion people will receive the gospel by 2020. Now, that's all just in Hong Kong. Now, what I want to point out here, besides just celebrating for what Jesus is doing and all these leaders in their hearts and the acceleration that's taking place, that in itself is just, that's praise time all day. But I'm trying to lay down a foundation here of understanding of where we are in the events of human history, where we are in the events of church history. We're at a moment in time where everything is accelerating. Now, in that encounter I had with the Lord in January of 2007, when I was called to do the GPN thing, the Lord showed me I had to have two tracks, had to service two tracks. One was the assembling of the older leaders, the established leaders is a better term. I don't like old anymore. The established leaders who have positions of authority and influence, they had to convene. We'll continue to do that all throughout different regions around the world as the Lord gives us wisdom. We have 10 other locations scheduled coming in the next year, and we'll just keep doing that. And that's necessary. That opens doors. Those people have immediate influence to see activity and change. There's a whole new vocabulary that's coming. A lot of that vocabulary is coming from our family in YWAM. And that's not something to be egotistical about. It just means the Lord's allowing us to serve in that capacity. That some of this language that's beginning to be used by the body of Christ, they won't identify where it came from, but some of it says come from our family. Some of it from this guy right over here. But the Lord's doing something with that. But what he showed me in that time, and I want you to get this because I believe we're going to be in various levels tracking this stuff together. Okay, not just through this thing called Call2All. Do not think of Call2All as an organization. Everything's organized. You've got to do that, right? Dates, people, places. You got to organize structures of different kinds. But the proper way to see this is a movement. And there's two aspects to the movement. We need to love both of them. We don't want to see them compete with each other. One is among the established leaders. We'll continue to assemble them. They'll strategize together. There'll be a lot of end results. They can move their organizations. That is a grace of God on a couple levels. That is a grace to allow a lot of organizations that are even past their primes in some respects. Okay, they're not on the front edge of something, but they're maintaining some things to give them a place in this move of God that's coming to the earth. You know, many others are involved. I'm not suggesting that all of them are over the hill. But God wants everybody in and what he's doing in the earth. He loves them all, and he wants them all in. So we'll keep doing that, keep stewarding that peace, and that's growing. There's thousands of people in that now that are participating through some level of partnership. We don't even try to post it anymore. It's can't even do that. The second stream, though, is one I want to point out this week heavily. What the Lord showed me is that the real aspects of the new release of the glory of the Lord in the earth is going to be carried by an emerging generation, many of whom are still children. They're not even teens and college students yet. They're children. And this is the, and I saw this. And I just saw it in the vision like I'm looking at you. This is the group that's going to be the new breed, which I'll talk about later in the week on Wednesday night. Please do not miss that. I'm not promoting when I'm speaking at all. But I believe that message is going to be a key one to understand even what we're stewarding in these coming days. But there's a whole new group God's bringing forth. And I'm just calling them, whether it's good or bad, all names are inadequate, Call2All Next Generation. And that group is going to be the one that really carries a lot of the energy and pushes us to the finish line. And that's the one that's emerging. In January, we're going to launch that alongside the first 50th anniversary celebration of YWAM. We're going to launch that in New Zealand. And I'll give you more on that later. But I just believe God's going to bust out. I just came from New Zealand yesterday, and there is such an anticipation, so much prophetic understanding that's coming. But that's the other stream. So we have the one stream going here with the established leaders, and the Lord's going to bring the second stream, or of a line here, which is the Call2All Next Generation piece. All the generations are going to be engaged with each other on different levels. And that, I believe, will mark a whole new phase in what's going to be going on here in the terms of the future of what's happening in the world through missions. I believe hundreds of thousands of new missionaries are going to be released, and one of the jobs we're going to need to have in this next season is we're going to have to give them on-ramps into this thing called missions. Now, they'll figure it out anyway, but you know, if we want in on this thing, let's get ready. Let's prepare the on-ramps, whatever that looks like. Let's get lots of, you know what I mean by on-ramp? You know, you have freeways, motorways, whatever country you're from, and you have to get on them. If we want them on this thing, and we want them to move quick, we've got to bring them the right understanding. We've got to give them access. We've got to create opportunities. I mean, they'll define a lot of it for us. But let's take what we know, and let's make room for this next group so they can move fast, and they can be deep, and we can jump in with them as we even serve them in leadership. Okay, that's coming. Now, that's just a backdrop to what I'm going to tell you right now. That's important. I hope that convinces you a little bit that some things are happening pretty fast. Okay, as I was praying this morning, early morning, my wife actually called. It's so nice when she prays and gets things from God and just helps me. It saves me a lot of time. But I want to just talk for a second about four giants to give a viewpoint here, one in particular. Four giants of in our time that have to be dealt with if we want to see the whole earth have an understanding of who Jesus is. If we want to see his kingdom established on some level here all across the earth, we have to understand what's going on with four different giants. Worldviews is essentially what they are. When we were in Hong Kong, we were dealing with three of them directly. David put together with his staff here at 4K a Silk Road map. Now, the only way I can describe it is picture a map about, I don't know, how was it the size of this, half the size of this? What was it, David? Oh, 1.5 the size of this, okay, which laid out the old Silk Road routes from China over to Israel, okay, if you can picture that, which takes him through all these different parts of Asia into the Middle East. And what when in along the route, you've got Buddhism, Hinduism, and Islam, three of the giants. And what we did, and it was a powerful movement, is we had one night a representation from Israel, came from Jerusalem on that end over here, crying out and saying to all the different Chinese leaders who were present standing on the map on that end, come! And they said yes, and they marched through all of these areas back to Jerusalem, called the Back to Jerusalem Movement. We actually walked that out. Guys, it was electric. Again, just using that term. I don't know, that's not the right term. The presence of the Lord was so on it, saying yes. Anyway, we participated with all of that as they marched across the map. Now, and then we had the rest of the leaders from the other 100 nations get behind them, again, as a picture, understanding our role, because largely the Lord's going to raise that church up quickly, release them with an open door. They're prepared by the Lord to even be martyred if necessary to go through those final things. I love that the folks from India were there, and they were saying, "Don't forget us!" And we won't. They're going to be a huge group in this whole picture. I picture even, you know, as the Chinese church moves, the Indian church rises up, many others. But there's going to be such a deluge of missionaries moving through those three giants. And we're totally celebrating that. All of them at a different level. Buddhism is collapsing, has largely collapsed in most forms. We're seeing Hinduism, you know, collapsing. People are being converted by the millions. You know, so many large numbers, it's hard to even deal with. Islam is being challenged on many levels. Indonesia, there's various numbers coming out. Many say it's over 20% Christian. You know, in India, I had a lot of time personally in India, watched, you know, hundreds of thousands of Muslims convert. There's a lot of things happening. The Middle East, there's things stirring, supernatural things happening. For one thing for sure is a lot of the extreme Islamic leaders or groups are exposed. They're out into the light, which is a really important thing to get people's attention, to focus on them. All right, so these three giants are being dealt with. Now, there is a fourth giant we have to pay attention to. And it's something, unfortunately, that I've been deeply immersed in all my life. I'm aware of it. That doesn't mean I instantly am free from it. But the fourth giant is humanism. Now, humanism has different forms to it. You know, it's a worldview which says man is God. Very few people that follow humanism say that. There are forms of humanism that say there is no God, even though they act like one. Okay, secular humanism. Now, secular humanism was dealt all kinds of different blows in most of our lifetimes. We watched the demise of the Soviet Union. And, you know, all these nations in Eastern Europe getting freed up and moves of God in Russia and so on. Okay, we watched, just saw more of it in China, what the Lord has been doing there in communist China. That's not really communist China anymore in many respects. They have more freedom in some areas than we have in the United States. Like, for instance, Alpha courses, Christian curriculums mandatory in the public schools. Okay, a lot of real positive things happening there. So I don't think that the immediate challenge is from secular humanism, though you're going to see that emerge again, I believe. But we see instead religious humanism. Now, religious humanism is a little bit tricky, because religious humanism doesn't call itself humanism. It takes on a form of religion. And you see this heavily in Western Europe. You see it very strong in the United States, Canada, you know, other different Western nations, the Commonwealth nations of the world. They would call themselves Christian or believers or men or women of faith. There's lots of language around this. But they live 100% just about as humanists. And it's couched, now let's get this, you guys, the seduction of this we have to catch, because many of the believers in the earth are going to be caught by this seduction. We're warned about this in Matthew 24, many other places. The love of most growing cold. It's framed in a humanitarian language. It takes on a humanitarian appearance. It talks of peace, safety and security, all of which we want. Okay? Now, we have a challenge, and I'm jumping ahead of myself. I'm going to come back to that and say it again. But we have a challenge as believers to understand this and be who we are meant to be, because the only way peace will come is through the Prince of Peace. The only way that true humanitarian work is going to be done is through people that actually carry a certain character about them that comes from Jesus. The rest will end up, as David talked about, being used to manipulate cultures, which you're watching, but people don't understand. They don't identify. Peace, safety, security. I mean, there's a lot of things going on under those terms right now that's quite demonic. Politicians know what the language is. They know if they just throw it out there, they'll get voted for. And Christians vote for them because they don't know the difference and they're not spiritually discerned. Now, sometimes they lead the charge. And they don't identify the other points, which you always have to look for. Watch how the leaders treat abortion. Okay, if you look at that subject alone, because the most demonic thing going on in the world right now is the murder of the unborn. There's nothing close. Because it's always the destruction of the most innocent, and there's nobody more innocent than the one in the womb. There's been a half a billion abortions, at least, maybe as many as a billion. And that's where the enemy gets a lot of his strength. A lot of the demonic strength in the world comes through the slaughter of the unborn. It is the unseen, unspoken about murder of the masses. It's way more horrific than the Second World War with the Nazis toward the Jews. It's way more horrific than all of the other slaughters of people around the world in large numbers, because it's bigger in number and it's the most innocent. But it's not talked about. Nobody talks about it as the Great Holocaust. It's a greater Holocaust than anything we've ever seen in history. And it's continuing on right now. It's up and down this coast. It's all over our nations. It's happening all around us. And the Christians are not stopping it for the most part. Now, when a leader stands up and they will not take a position concerning that, let me say it another way. When they stand up and advocate the continuance of it and help it and fund it, you know that the roots of that authority come from the powers of hell. It doesn't matter if they use all the other humanitarian language, peace and safety language, all of the other things, you see, because that will be the face of the rise of the Babylonian system. That's what the Bible calls it. We call it humanism, but the Bible calls it Babylon, which is a city, Babylon, which is a system. It is the system that rises at the end of the age. It's the one the Antichrist comes in on. Okay? It is the one to really concern ourselves most with. It doesn't mean we don't care about the other ones, but is the system that's going to usurp all the other systems. And it's a Trojan horse. You know the story of the Trojan horse. It's offered as a gift and then inside our armies. Humanism's coming in as a gift. Peace, safety, humanitarian aid, curing disease, all these things are going to be touted and are touted. And inside it is a whole demonic army taking over cultures with humanistic thought, which is based in sensuality for real. It's self-indulgence, it's personal gratification. And again, leaders, power brokers on various levels know this. Corporations know it, politicians know it. The power brokers know that if they use the language of humanitarian stuff, if they talk about peace and safety, they can put through anything they want. All right. This is the fourth giant that concerns me the most. This giant is not being talked about in most mission circles. It's not on the UPG list. It's not on the orality discussion. It's not the one being talked about. We are talking about the other giants, which are important to talk about. I'm leading a charge in some respects in some of those other discussions, but I am being stirred by the Lord heavily right now that we have a Trojan horse in our midst, that right behind all this missions activity going through the other giants of the world is this deluge of humanism. And one of the great ironies is that the nation that's been used the most in the last few generations to spread missions activity around the world, the United States, is also the nation that's spreading very rapidly humanism all over the world. And it's not being called that. It's confusing the world because those who are from our nation that deal in humanism on many levels are still allowing people to believe it's a Christian nation. And so they categorize the activity as Christian. This is a very, very dangerous situation. And we have to be aware of this fourth giant. We have to have mission strategies. Now, the foundations are in Western Europe. But Western Europe is not the exporter right now. That's where the foundations lie. But the exporter is the United States primarily, but there's also a lot of exporting being done by the Commonwealth nations. You know, those who've been influenced by particularly the UK. And so you look at Australia, New Zealand, on and on and on. But we have to study this. We have to map this. We have to talk about this. We've got to put numbers to it. We've got to re-evangelize with the right perspective, a kingdom perspective, the humanistic nations of the world, and we've got to see them as who they are. It's an alternate system and worldview to God's kingdom, to true theism. It calls itself theism. That's what makes it wicked, more wicked, is it's called theism, but it's humanism. It's going to be the one that actually, I think, will ultimately take over Islam. There'll be a hybrid. There'll still be the formality of Islam, but it'll be essentially humanism. And that is really dangerous. And so it could be with all the others. Okay? So we've got to pay attention to this final giant, and I believe that the Lord's revealing this in various ways right now, because even as we negotiate this thing called Call2All with the established leaders and the emerging leaders, there has to be an awareness. I have asked the Lord over and over. I'm in Kansas City, Missouri. That's where I've lived for 10 years. My family is all coming here on August 12th, 13th, and 14th. You know, we're going to be living right above the campus here in one of the condos. And but I'm asking the Lord, Lord, why did you immerse me for 10 years in this prayer movement in Kansas City? Why did you immerse me all over the world in prayer movements? Why am I around these young people? Mostly during these 10 years, they haven't talked so much about missions. They are hugely now, by the way. But why have they been so consumed, like these two young men up on the stage, so consumed with just the face of God and intimacy? And why do they spend all their time fasting and praying? Lord, what is this? The Lord is preparing a generation as a counter-movement to the humanism that's arising in the earth. It's the counter-movement. They are not going to be subject to the seduction, because it's a huge seduction. And I'm so aware of my own immersion in the seduction in my life. You know, as I take a look at issues of sensuality and pride and idolatry and how I spend my time and my money, I'm really appalled. I was almost at the point this morning about 7 a.m., and I'm not making this up, not trying to be, you know, some false humility. I was really like, should I even talk about this? Am I even qualified to discuss this? Because I'm so immersed in it myself. There's so much repentance yet that has to happen in my life. You know, I was talking to my wife this morning about it because she's further down the road from repenting. That's probably why the Lord gave her a lot of these insights this morning. But we've got to be aware of this, and the Lord needs to help us. Now, I want to read a scripture to you, and we close our time here in just about 5 minutes. I'm just setting the table, really, for something I believe that's going to kind of mark where we're going with some of the Call2All discussion this week. But in Revelation 17, it talks about the woman on the beast. I just want to read a little bit of it. You just listen to this. John's getting a revelation about the end time events, and he's seeing here the judgment of Babylon. But there's some language. Now, again, Babylon, the great mother of prostitutes, it's called in Scripture, the abominations of the earth. Okay? And the Lord is going to judge it, and ultimately the Lord Jesus is the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. He's going to bring it to a head. But he wants us to understand this and know what we're dealing with so we're not done in by it ourselves. But not only that, on a personal level, that we understand it as one of our missions tasks, to oppose it and rise up against it. Probably the greatest missions task at the end of the age, because all the language of Scripture and prophecy deals with this system. The rise of Babylon, the mark of the beast, you know, 666, all these things, which is commerce related. A lot of it's related to money, power broking over people, buying and selling of people. There's a lot of stuff that goes on that's part of this. And we've got to understand more about it. But it says, one of the seven angels who had the seven bowls, which are judgments that are poured out in the latter days, said to me, come, I will show you the punishment of the great prostitute who sits on many waters. Waters are the nations, the languages of the world. The peoples, nations, and languages of the world. So that this prostitute sits on those. Understand that language. It's said over and over and over in Scripture. Because this, we deal with other portions of Scripture where we talk about the nations and the tribes and so on before the throne of God. Understand that same language is used when it talks about the prostitute sitting on the waters. Because this Babylonian system sits on the peoples, nations, languages of the world. And it says, verse 2, with her the kings of the earth commit adultery. And the inhabitants of the earth are intoxicated with the wine of her adulteries. You get the picture? Down a little bit further, it's talked about she held in a golden cup in her hand filled with the abominable things and the filth of her adulteries. This title was written on her forehead, Mystery Babylon the Great, the mother of prostitutes and the abominations of the earth. And I saw the woman was drunk with the blood of the saints, the blood of those who bore the testimony of Jesus. All right, so let's understand this. The greatest enemy is the church that's aware who she is and opposes her. And the enemy's plan will be to kill us, to stop us, because this is the great conflict that's coming. You see, this is the conflict of conflicts that's coming. The great martyrdom that's going to take place, the great falling away, the betrayal of one another talked about in Matthew 24 is all going to be attached to this. And it's hugely seductive. This is going to be very tricky, you guys. You got to get this. And there are people, many of us in this room have already been seduced on various levels. I'm dealing with that personally because it's so subtle. You watch your language shift from kingdom language and you start dealing with language of tolerance, which is the number one thing that humanists practice or at least talk about. They don't practice it, but it's the highest value or spoken value. But you start to use this kind of wishy-washy language, not the kingdom language, and a new Jesus starts to emerge that's not the Jesus of the Bible. It's not the Jesus of justice that's going to come back with the wrath of God. It's a different kind of Jesus. It's not the Jesus that went to a cross and died to show us the way and how we should live. It's a different kind of Jesus. It's all mushy and fuzzy. And we're going to, not only are we going to have to be free from anything that would intoxicate or grab us, we're going to help a whole generation to be free. And the purest way to do that, of course, is interface with the Lord himself in fasting and prayer. It is not enough to say I'm part of a prayer movement, be attached to it on the peripheral, say I'm for it, be energized by the language of it, but not be in it. If we are not living a fasted lifestyle in the midst of it, and I'm speaking to a mirror right now, I'm very convicted by this. If we aren't living that kind of lifestyle ourselves, then it's hypocrisy, and we actually are a problem because we say we value it, but we don't live like it, so therefore we're not an example of it. And we confuse a whole generation. This is a huge responsibility. I'm going to read just one more portion here. In the 18th chapter, we see the judgment of this apostate system, Babylon, in the form of a description of the judgment of a city that arises called Babylon in the last days. But it says in chapter 18, after this I saw another angel coming down from heaven. He had great authority, and the earth was illuminated by his splendor. With a mighty voice he shouted, fallen, fallen is Babylon the Great. She has become a home for demons, a haunt for every evil spirit, for everything that's unclean or detestable. For all the nations have drunk the maddening wine of her adulteries. The kings of the earth committed adultery with her, and the merchants of the earth grew rich from her excessive luxuries. And then this is important. This is the verse I want to really end with. Verse 4, then I heard another voice from heaven say, come out of her, my people, so that you will not share in her sins and then in her judgment. I believe that's a really important word for right now. We'll get around missionally this whole thing called humanism and what it looks like in Europe and North America and other parts of the world. But we have got to understand on a personal level, we have got to come out. Now, I've thought a lot about, and I'm, boy, there's so much in me on this, but saying, Lord, why am I going to Kona with my family? What is this thing about the Pacific where almost nobody lives? You know, we're dealing with the masses and masses of people in these other locations. And I want you to pray into this with me. I've got some insights. I don't know that I'm even going to share them all right now. This has been a process for a long time, actually, almost 20 years. But there's something about this place right here, this campus, this Kona City, this island, this state, that is very important in the unfolding of this whole thing I'm talking about right now. I don't think it's a coincidence that this place is defined really by humanistic gratification. There's even a lot of people who come to schools here because it's Hawaii, and they think of beaches and pleasure. There's something that's meant to emerge here. Here being this campus, here being this city, here being this island, this state. There's something that's supposed to emerge here that actually has an opposite spirit to it, that shows the beauty of the Lord, which there's so much beauty here in a natural sense, and so much beauty in the people. Something of the beauty of the Lord is seen, but it's actually not sensual. It's very holy. It's very set apart. And it's meant to be here in such a way that people come here not for the beaches and for the palm trees, but they come here because they want to view the beauty of the Lord. And in that environment, they receive clarity and instruction and the role they're to play and find out who they are and all the missional pieces. They come in the beauty of the Lord. They don't just come as this thing that's just going to wear you out and leave you all tired. And that, again, is one of the strategies of the enemy. As I prayed about even this campus and, you know, us, the Lord allowed me to see almost like loads being carried. And the God's, I think, going to bring something in terms of his anointing that's going to pull the loads off. And we're going to find out a whole new level of what it means to run with the Lord, because his yoke is easy and his burden is light. But that isn't true except in his presence. That's the only place that happens. And then we're going to be allowed to do things that are greater than we could ever imagine. Okay, and I think it'll kind of come simultaneously. But I just have to give you, I have a picture that I believe the Lord's trying to crystallize in my heart, just for my role, my family, while we're here. And I know many come with many different insights, probably more than mine. But it's important for me to know, because I want to redeem time. I want to be in the right places. I want to do what the Lord wants. Ultimately, I'm responsible to please him. Just as you are, we all are. But I just leave that with you. You can just process that, just see what the Lord might show you about that. But I have a picture in my heart. You know, Martin Luther King Jr. said, I have a dream. Well, I have a dream of, one of the dreams the Lord's brought forth is that this place would emanate, just like the New Jerusalem, the city of God itself, would, you know, emulate the beauty of the Lord, and the fragrance of the Lord would be such that not only are we captivated, but the world wants to come and be captivated, and in that environment we train. So I'll leave you with that. Thank you for the time this morning.
I think if you're like me, our spirits have been whetted, aren't they? You're hungry for more, and God's just, in these days, giving us perspective of what he's wanting to do. And in our spirits, we have to rise in faith to take hold of God's purposes and say, you know, he is sharing this with us because he wants to include us in the process of bringing his solutions, his transformation, his redemption into the world. So we have been talking about impartation. And if you would like just God to touch you now around this theme, I would like to ask you, Mark, to just pray for an impartation of insight, and that we would be moved in our spirits with an awareness of these four giants and this one, that this humanistic giant, which is the one that has so controlled the parts of the world where most of us live, that we would just say, God, we want to rise up in your power to see that dealt with in my life and then through my life to become an agent of your transformation. So if that's in your heart, would you just stand and extend your hands out as to receive from the Lord? And we're just going to ask Mark to lead us in prayer, that we would just, we would all walk into this, because we all stand in need of God's working in our own lives.
Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. You know, Father, even as we're standing together, and I'm standing, and I was already standing, but I just stand up again. And I say, Father, we come to you in Jesus' name, knowing you're the only one that can bring this to us. Thank you for sending your Son, not only as a price, as a sacrifice for us, but as a continuing mediator and Lord. Lord Jesus, we submit to you everything we are, right where we are right now. Lord God, you know everything about us. And we're amazed at your love. But Lord, we don't want to be passive about sin. We don't want to be passive about sensuality, in particular in this time that comes from humanism. Lord, deliver us. Help us to be everything we are meant to be in this season. Lord, allow us to be the instruments you have in your hands in this time, in this place, wherever we're posted around the world, whatever assignment you gave us. We want to flow with you in this final day. Lord, bring to us a greater grace, a greater understanding that's part of your grace. Open our understanding, Lord, so we see. Give us a wisdom in this season, where we're caught, where we're intoxicated, where we're captured by the enemy, where we have worldview issues that are wrong, and in our core we have things that we believe that are lies. Lord, deliver us from that. God, help us in this whole process together. God, we trust you'll make us strong, not only surviving the days that are ahead, but in fact prospering in your hand and being used of you in all the ways you have in mind. We trust you, Jesus. Lead us. We give ourselves to you afresh. We love you, Lord. We want to love you more. Give us more capacity to love you. We want to really be ruined face to face with you, captured by your beauty. Thank you, Jesus.
As we close, why don't we just together, as we often say, Korean style, just speak out love words to Jesus. This is what its bottom line is about, that he becomes the sole and supreme affection of our heart. That changes us individually. That propels us into action globally. So just tell him how much you love him. Jesus, we gladly dethrone ourselves and we gladly exalt you. There is no one like you. Extraordinary, beautiful, awesome, incredible in all your ways, always just so compassionate, looking for every opportunity to extend forgiveness and mercy. You're trustworthy, dependable. Lord Jesus, you are everything our spirit has ever longed for. You're the truth, the beauty, the joy, the fragrance, the delight. Lord, we have at times allowed other things to capture our attention, but in moments of frank reality, we realize you and you alone are our supreme joy and our eternal hearts to you. And I pray, Lord, that throughout these days, you'd meet us deeply at the most devotional and intimate encounter between us and you, and that out of that love dynamic, you would show us how you've gifted us to act in the world in order that many, many more might grow in their love for you as well. Lord, thank you for this morning. Just continue to seal this word in our hearts. Continue to work it deeper into us. Lead us throughout this day to just be turning our hearts and minds towards you, to love you. You're so, so wonderful. You're such a delight to us. And we turn to you. We turn to you. Is that right? We turn to you, Jesus. Amen.